That was the Reverend George Mason of Wilshire Baptist Church in Dallas speaking there about the fiance of Thomas Eric Duncan. A prayer vigil for Duncan was held last night at Wilshire Baptist, which is where Louise Tro worships. She is in quarantine. She was unable to attend. But local media reports say she was able to watch the service as it was streamed online.
There's one woman who knows all too well about how Duncan's family is feeling right now. Her name is DeConti Kofa. Kofa also lost her husband to Ebola, and she joins us now. DeConti, I've had a chance to speak with you a couple of times since Patrick's passing, and I know one of the things you said that you wanted to do was to provide some support to Louise and her family, because you are in an emotional place where you sadly can relate to what she's going through. Have you had a chance to talk to her yet? And if you haven't, what would you like to say to her?
Yeah, so we haven't had a chance to talk with Louise yet, understandably so. She's going through so much, and I know what that feels like. And sometimes you don't even want to talk with anyone. And so I would just like to reach out to her and just, again, wrap my arms around her and letting her know that you're not alone, sister. You're not alone. It's tough. I can empathize with what you're going through. And it is unique to you, so I may not fully understand all of your emotions, but I have went through similar, and I can really, really empathize. And so my prayers goes out to her. And I will continue to make an effort. In fact, we're planning a trip down to Texas to reach out to Louise, and because no one should be alone during this time. And that's what Ebola does. It isolates you. It isolates you.
What does it do to the community? And by that I mean perhaps the Liberian community or the West African community in Dallas right now. There are a lot of people there who are saying they feel isolated, that they feel, in a way, almost discriminated against, a sense of fear.
There is a fear, and that fear is real, and that fear does exist. The people feel isolated. And then on the other hand, I can see the folks who may be doing the isolating, who are afraid of getting Ebola, and that fear is real too, right? So something needs to be done fast, because we can't continue this pattern.
What do you think the things are that need to be done? It's interesting. We've been talking to a lot of medical professionals, and obviously in terms of, you know, handling fear and managing people's concern about the spread of Ebola here, we have seen medical professionals doing what they can to make sure that all of our medical centers are prepared and ready in the case they have a patient come present to their hospital that seems sick. But it's not just the preparation. It seems to me that there's an awareness that needs to, be spread around the nation too, no?
Yeah. Yes, yes, there's that awareness that needs to be spread around the nation as well. There are certain things that, you know, let's talk about the red flags here of Duncan being sent home, you know, his first trip. So a man from Liberia, you know, where Ebola is rampant, comes to a hospital, and I think mentioned that he was from Liberia. I'm not 100% certain, but I'm thinking that's what it was, and he was sent home when he talked about his symptoms. So just that, those little things that should be red flags to say, hey, let's keep him here and let's do some testing, are the sort of things we want to look at. But then also to be compassionate first and foremost. So even if those red flags do go up, these are human beings. We're people just like you. You know, treat me how you would want to be treated. So even though we may be afraid, that fear is real, but at the same time, know that you're dealing with another human being who has feelings just like you.
You know, you're in the United States now, obviously, looking at what's happening here and also looking at what's happening in West Africa. What do you make of the level of engagement here and in some of the Western countries with what is happening in those three countries? You know, I was struck by, you know, this dog was put down yesterday, which was very sad, but 390,000 people signed a petition, you know, in support of this dog. I'm not sure I've seen that same level of concern for what's happening in some of these countries.
Yeah, we're slow. We're slow. It's taken us a while to catch up and to be at that level of concern that we should be. We unfortunately here a lot of the times in the U.S. care more for our animals than we do for our neighbors. And that's sad. So we need to definitely work on that. But there are a lot of good people who are stepping it up,
there
who are concerned.
Are.
And I want to recognize that, too.
And there's a lot of people that are, we know, there's a lot, certainly a lot of missionaries and medical professionals, doctors, nurses, mm-hmm. and assistants that are, that have headed yeah. over and have committed their lives to working with the people that are fighting that battle, one that it seems that we are losing in West Africa. Dekante, thank you so much for making yourself available to us, and we hope to stay in touch with you, okay?
Thank you so much for having me, and again, we at the COFA Foundation are at the front line of this fight. And so you can visit our website at COFAFoundation.org. And yes, we're taking donations. So please help us out.